different. Yeah, okay. I'll give you a little bit brief on Aristotle as well. I won't go into teleology and some of these other ideas. They won't directly relate to Deleuze. But I mentioned quite briefly the idea that Aristotle's critique of the forms, one of Aristotle's central claims is that if the forms are linked to knowledge, you have to know the forms to know things, and the forms are therefore the principles upon which you have knowledge of the physical world, that there needs to be a limited number of them. The forms need to be explain more things. There needs to be a single form that explains many things. So there have to be a limit to the number of forms. If there were an infinite number of forms and an infinite number of things that reflected these infinite numbers of forms, then the forms couldn't serve as a foundation for knowledge. Right? You couldn't have as many principles as you could have. And that's where you get into this whole thing that the forms are, there's no limit to the forms. Right? So without going into some of the ways in which Aristotle tries to kind of deal with that, I'll speak to the part which Deleuze himself directly talks about, which is Aristotle on definition, because that's the way in which Aristotle is going to try and understand, rather than forms which things reflect, and those forms give them their specificity, all right, they can be defined in relation to how they reflect the forms and so forth. Aristotle will seek to understand, to define things through a notion of genus and species and differentia. Right? So a different kind of hierarchy emerges, a different kind of problems of definition emerge. To define something is to state its essential form, its unchanging form, its essential as opposed to its accidental predicates. Right? So famously, human beings are rational animals, birds are winged animals, that's what's essential to being human is rationality. You know, Socrates may have a snub nose, but that's an accidental trait. For example, the shape of his nose, the color of his skin, his height, and so forth. Whether he's sitting or standing, it's the same Socrates and the like. All right. This is what Deleuze will himself discuss in terms of the idea of difference in what he calls organic representation in the first chapter of Difference and Repetition. The example he gives is Aristotle. It's the idea of the genus divided into species. So animal is a genus or a general category. Birds and humans are species, which are specific categories. All right, they're still categories, they're still groups. All right, then within humans, you might have Socrates as one individual, Plato as another individual. All right, but what they share in common is that they're human beings, and their essence is found in their humanity. All right, human beings are rational animals. They share something with birds, but they're distinct from something that from birds in a different way. Right? They share a common genus, but their genus is differentiated by different characteristics. So this is a genus general category, species a specific category. This is the specific difference, all right? Or the specifying difference. It's what turns a general category, a genus, into a species, right? Through a form of division. And it also is what realizes or concretizes the genus. All right, so, and this is going to be Aristotle's understanding of definition. And what makes it a definition is it's complete. It's kind of its reversibility. So if I said, what is a human being? It's a rational animal. And I ask, what is a rational animal? The answer is it's a human being. And it's exhaustive in that way. All right, I can't say a human being is something other than a rational animal. I can't say something other than a rational. A rational animal is something other than a human being. It won't be a bird. It won't be something else. All right, and this is, as Deleuze himself will say, everything Aristotle tries to do operates around this middle of genus and species. Doesn't really touch individuals. Individuals are going to be humans, right, who are differentiated. Aristotle will refer to these as individual differences. There'll be a whole question around those, right, and their status, which we'll probably is better to get into when we discuss difference and repetition, all right? Individual differences in many respects are going to be different from specific difference. Now, Deleuze will make the claim, and this is in Aristotle in the Metaphysics, specific difference, or really contrariety, is the most perfect form of difference, he will say, all right? Contraries are positive differentiations, winged, rational, and so forth. They can be given negative form, but they can also be given positive form. So they're different from contradictories, all right? And that's going to be an issue when we get to Hegel as well. One of Hippolyte's claims about Hegel is that Hegel pushes difference to contradiction, right? That contradiction is the more expansive form of difference. This is going to be the debate that Deleuze enters into. But being and non-being are contradictories because the non-being can't be given a positive status. But if I say something's not rational, it could still be winged or something else, all right? So these differentia have a positive character, and they divide up a positive genus into species, all right? And they represent kind of the extremes of difference that could fit within this common identity, all right? Animal could be winged, it could be two-footed, it could be four-footed, it could be rational, all right? But it's still an animal of a type of animal, all right? And it's not a rock, it's not a plant, it's not something else. All right? Animal, this is a genus, is part of a category called substance. Substance is one of the categories of being. And there are other substances, okay, which are these categories are even higher forms of identity than genera and species. About 10 categories: substance, quantity, quality, location, time, relation, number of others, all right? And they're all meant to be categories of being. So there's going to be this way in which definition works by sets, in a way, group theory, in a way, okay? Smaller groups which are part of bigger groups which are divided from each other by certain differences that they share in common, all right? Individuals fall under groups and the like. Now, just like the Platonic thing I put on the board, there's problems on both sides of these, both at the bottom, both at the top. That's why Deleuze says Aristotle always operates in the middle regions in terms of where animals, where genuses and species operate. First thing is that down here are individuals. Individuals can't be defined, and hence can't be known. And Aristotle himself admits this. He says the only thing that can be defined, because it can be given a reciprocal definition, are species in relation to a genus. All right? You can say rational animals are humans, humans are rational animals, and nothing else. Humans are only rational animals are only humans. Right? But these other differences, Aristotle will admit, cannot be defined because they cannot be, their definition cannot be exhausted by general categories, by categories that apply beyond themselves. Right? So if I wanted to say define Socrates by listing the differences, make Socrates different from all other humans, that make him this human as opposed to any other, just the same way humans are defined in such a way that they're this animal rather than any other animal, the list would be endless and would always be incomplete. So I could talk about Socrates' height, his skin color, his hair, you know, his eyes, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? I could always be describing Socrates' identical twin. I think Derrida makes this point. I could always be describing the fictional Socrates who's identical in every way. You can always posit, like, the absolutely identical twin. Ultimately, Aristotle will say, there has to be a final definition or a final predication that defines Socrates, but it's going to necessarily be individual, and therefore it's not going to be a definition again at all. A different way of putting it is, or an example of it is, this is a Bisleri mineral water with added minerals, water bottle. What makes this is a water bottle, and this is this water bottle. What makes this water bottle, as opposed to all the other Bisleri water bottles out there? What makes it this one?
This soda.
But there could be soda in any of the others. And that's because I'm an American and I need to live on Coke. Coca-Cola, that is. But, okay.
Talking about particularly the one.
Yeah. Exactly. So, you know, Socrates is this tall fellow who has this, 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 and this. And by the way, he's the one who's standing over there. All right? And that's kind of the final indication of what Socrates is. That's why, what's the difference between this bottle and a bottle? This is this bottle. It's the one I'm holding in my hand right now. It's made up of this particular material. But whenever I do that, when I point to it, pointing to something isn't defining it, it's designating it. All right? So Socrates is the one over there. And that's going to be the point. There's no definition of an individual. There's only a designation of an individual and a recognition of an individual that falls into a species. Aristotle says it's, I think this one's also in the Metaphysics, there's no knowledge of an, all you can do is define the species triangle and then recognize that an individual is a triangle, that it falls into that species of shape, right? So individuals themselves aren't definable. They're going to be something around the aspect of the differences that make an individual that is different from a comprehensible or conceptual difference, right? If that makes sense, all right? The other side is up here. Being, Aristotle will say, is not a common genus. It's not a highest identity, all right? You know, you've heard of the paradox of the set of all sets. You cannot have a set of all sets. It's from Bertrand Russell and early set theory. If you don't, you don't need to know it. Anyway, this is a kind of very early formulation of the same problem, right? And this is the one Deleuze actually focuses on kind of directly in his discussion of Aristotle, although the question of individuation he also discusses, and you can tie it to, it's an Aristotelian problem. But as I said, there's 10 categories, all right, different categories. Being is not a common identity that encapsulates them, the way that substance is a common identity that encapsulates animals and plants and inanimate objects, or the way that animal is a category, a common identity for humans, birds, and all the other sorts of animals. Why? Because specific differences are, is what Deleuze says, basically what Aristotle says as well. When I say animal, an animal is a predicate in a sentence, I can say humans are animals, say birds are animals, say Socrates is an animal, but I can't say that rational is an animal. I can't say winged is an animal, right? Because winged and rational are the differences that divide up this category into smaller categories, right? Whereas these categories have an identity of animal in common with them, rational and winged, they're not animals, right? However, we say that they are. Animal is, winged is, birds are, Plato is. Being is predicated of all of them. So what being is predicated of, what it applies to, are identities and differences, all right? So it's not a common identity because it, in a way, applies to more things. It's wider than an identity category can be, all right? So there's this paradox of what is actually is a unification of these 10 categories, because they're all categories of being, but being isn't the thing they have in common. Because being is not an identity. It's not a category which encompasses. It's a category in a way that is too encompassing. All right? Does that make sense? Now, the argument that will follow out of Aristotle, and this is the one that Deleuze will pick up on and try and discuss, and this gets back to some of the things we said yesterday, is that being has a common sense, so that it's a name that can apply to everything. It doesn't specify anything meaning, it doesn't specify a common identity that all these things have, but it has specifies a common sense that they all have, which you can glimpse in certain laws around the nature of the use of being. Right? One of the things that can be said of all beings is a law of non-contradiction applies to them. Whether it's an animal, a substance, a quality, a quantity, it cannot be and not be at the same time and under the same relationship, right? And that would apply, but that's not a common identity, that's a common sense, right? And we'll discuss a bit more of that later on. But the issue here with respect to Hegel, or the reason bringing him up here, is one of the things this will mean for the notion of knowledge and therefore the notion of science is that science doesn't grasp individuals in Aristotle. And that's one of the things that Hegel will insist upon. knowledge to be absolute knowledge and to be genuine science has to be able to grasp the individual, all right? To show the place of the individual within something larger. And that that's going to be part of what dialectics does. Against Plato, knowledge can't rest on something transcendent. Against Aristotle, knowledge cannot remain abstract. Knowledge has to be concrete. Science has to be concrete. Concrete means it grasps individuals as individuals. All right? Does that make sense? Okay. We're going to get to Hegel soon. The last one to mention very briefly is Kant, who I'm not going to go into detail on, in part because there are people who are better at doing it than me, but in part just because one point needs to be made in relation to Hegel and then in relation to Nietzsche, which is the division that Kant will make between noumena and phenomena, or things in themselves and appearances. So, I assume you're nodding that you know what this is, right? Or things in themselves and things as they appear. One of Kant's central claims is that knowledge, the idea of knowledge, can be rescued as long as we accept that knowledge only applies to things as they appear and not things as they are. Right? And what he'll say with respect to that is, can I move back here now? All right. We have categories through which we understand things, but what we understand, we organize it through these categories, which in through these intuitions and concepts and categories, is things, it's only appearances, all right? And if you think about it, there's a logic to this. If I talk about this table here, and I say it's brown, it's wood, it's other things, all I'm doing is describing its properties, not what it is, all right? Hobbes, a nominalist philosopher and political theorist, will make a similar point about the nature of knowledge, that we only really are when we talk about knowledge, when I say something's red, right, or I say something's brown, all I'm saying, according to Hobbes, is that this thing, whatever it is, affects my eyes and my brain in such a way that I register a color brown. So what brown names, what brown designates, isn't what this thing is, it designates my reaction to it. It designates how I process it, okay? But it doesn't say what the thing is. Its properties always describe how it appears, all right? And so Kant will have his own kind of version of that. What our knowledge organizes is appearances. It organizes in ways which are necessary for us. So there's a derivation of the categories, or transcendental deduction of the categories, on the basis of the I think. I think is supposed to mean I think in these categories. That's supposed to safeguard knowledge, but it always remains knowledge of things as they appear. And Kant will say that there's a transcendental illusion, a mistake that reason itself makes every time it tries to think that through its the way in which it organizes the way things appears, it's actually grasping things as they are. Right? Now that idea is going to be savaged by Hegel, by Nietzsche, by everyone else afterwards. This idea that in separating a thing in itself from things as it appears, you're separating things from their properties, right? But then what is the thing in itself? Hegel will say this, Nietzsche will say this, Adorno will say this. The thing in itself is a nullity. It's a nothingness, all right? And so you might as well not even be making the separation anymore. Sorry, say this again, isn't Plato? Yeah, possibly. Oh, between forms as the unchanging in themselves and so forth. Yeah, maybe, but it not quite in... And yeah, in Plato there's also the original idea of the essence and appearance distinction. So, yeah, there is that. But it's Kant who will insist that we don't know things in themselves, only things as they appear. And that's going to be the way Kant insists on saving knowledge, in the same way he then insists that it saves faith, because there's a limit to knowledge, so there's a place that still exists for faith, there's a place that still exists for the belief that we're autonomous, because to be autonomous is to have free will, which means that we are not subject to causality, and causality is a necessary category of our understanding. Everything we witness, everything we experience, we organize in terms of causality. We see things, one thing following the other, we make causal connections. But if everything was subject to causality, we'd have no free will, but Kant will say that might be the way we appear to ourselves, always as effects of causes, but that isn't necessarily the way we are. So we could have free will. But then he can't ever prove that we have free will. Anyway, the way Hegel will deal with this is to, and Nietzsche will deal with this, is always to say if you separate a thing from its properties, the thing in itself from its properties, the thing in itself is a nothingness, right? And so it's a senseless distinction to make. It's a distinction literally makes no sense, right? Nietzsche has a wonderful little piece in The Will to Power, where he says the properties of a thing are its effects on other things, right? The property of red is its effect on my eyes and my brain processing that stimulus, right? The properties of the thing are always its effects on other things. If you removed other things, the thing would have no properties, because its properties are effects, right? A thing can only have properties without other things. There can be no thing in itself, right? A thing in itself which had no properties would be nothing, and therefore a thing can't exist without other things, without its relation to other things. I mean, think of it in a different way. Sorry? Yeah? Yeah.
If we have to support or defend the Kantian
distinction. Yeah.
So can I just say this in this way? I mean, for example, when I look at the bottle, mm-hmm. I mean, the way it appears, it's very subjective thing about this appearance.
Yeah.
If you are looking for some objective quality,
yeah.
No, that is something which is knowable, but the subjective qualities will differ or vary according to the person who is.
Right, okay.
So, in that way, you can differentiate between the essence as something which is objective,
yeah.
Given there,
yeah.
As something pre given, or appearance is something which is in the process of conceptualizing or conceiving, if not conceptualizing.
Okay.
Conceiving the object in a subjective way.
Okay, that might save a kind of distinction, I can accept that. But that's a sort of perspectivism, right? I mean, the claim that Hegel will make, that Nietzsche will make, that Hippolyte will make in reading Hegel, that Deleuze will quote approvingly, is essence is always seen as that thing behind the appearances, right? That's not appearing, but is behind the appearances. And that, this is Hegel's claim. What's behind the appearances is just the illusion that there's something behind the appearances, that there's nothing behind the appearances. So the thing in itself is nothing. A different way of putting it is, even if you accept that it appears to you one way, it appears to someone else the other way, right? That's a perspectivalism, right? It appears differently to different. That doesn't mean there's something behind the appearances. It just means there's a multiplicity of appearances, right? But that idea is that the distinction is untenable, right? And so what? Yeah.
Yeah. Making, between the inscape and the inscape, sort of.
Yeah.
Where the object is, how and why the object is the object.
Yeah.
And what is making that object unique from, say, the other object.
Right.
So that is a different, altogether different kind of investigations.
Yeah.
Where you are looking at the objectness of the object itself.
Different
from, the appearance.
Okay.
So, in that way, you can put the objectness of the object as something which is, the essence.
Yeah, I suppose we can try. And I suppose there's this whole idea of return of the object in a lot of this analysis. But, I mean, if nothing else, that's not the way Hegel will go. And it's not actually the way that Deleuze will be going either. All right? And they'll both hold to this idea that, there's one way of reading Kant, which is that he approaches something, but he's too timid to actually see through the full consequences of it. And that's why he kind of retreats to this idea, among other things, that there's still a thing in itself that, we don't know, but it's also irrelevant to knowledge because knowledge only applies to something else. Right. Anyway, yeah. No, don't worry. As we proceed, we're going to try and show how this other way of thinking works. And I mean, you know, it's not perfect either, but it is premised on the idea that distinction's untenable. Okay. We're ready to talk about Hegel. We've only been at this for an hour and a half with a short break. Are there any more questions before? Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Think about all the poets, romantic poets or whatever they're doing. They're basically going more. Beyond the appearance.
Yeah. No, fair enough. You know, one of the things that Nietzsche will then say about this is, once we get rid of the essence-appearance distinction, does that mean that all we have is appearances? And the answer is no, because the whole notion of appearance is defined against essence. So that has to go as well. I mean, Nietzsche says that this is kind of the moment of the appearance of Zarathustra, of like nihilism it's how he says, it's in a part of Twilight of the Idols called How the Real World Became a Myth. History of an illusion, or history of an error. And the error is that there was a real world as opposed to the world of appearance. Once you get rid of the real world, you also get rid of the world of appearances. What you end up with is a perspectival world, for example. So, I mean, you know, one thing to then ask is, what is the status of truth in a perspectival world? And Nietzsche doesn't say there's no such thing as truth in a perspectival world. He talks about the perspectivism of truth. And that's a Deleuzian idea as well. So, I mean, yeah, I mean, getting rid of essence, the essence-appearance distinction, modifies but doesn't necessarily get rid of the notion of truth, right? But it makes truth plural. So, you know, there will be this inescapable element in which your perspective and my perspective are irreconcilable or incompatible. There's no kind of Archimedean point to negotiate them. So the status of truth is something different. But that's why, you know, the status of truth, oh, I've erased that already, is it has something to do with reversing Platonism, changing the status of simulacra, and the like.
Yeah. So could you place the Spinoza's thought on realism, maybe something like the perspective of the real world, how would one perceive appearances? Because the idea of Hegel is looking at art.
Yeah.
Sensuous representation of ideas.
Yeah, of the absolute.
Absolute.
Yeah.
So, but Spinoza's perspective on myth is as much closer to the real world than the appearance or the perspective. Could you maybe put him there?
Sorry, put Spinoza where? As a perspectivalist or as a...
As a realist.
That is the way... Hegel would put him, for example. Yeah, I mean, Hegel's.
So Deleuze.
No, in a way, not. I mean, Hegel has a certain dismissal of Spinoza, for among other things, not recognizing the dialectic, not understanding the notion of the negative. Creating this notion of substance, which is transcendent. I mean, Deleuze's kind of recovery of Spinoza is a very Deleuzian move, which turns what he does into a critique of Hegel. I need to think about that. I'd also need to look at some things again. Let me not answer that today, and let me try and remember Let me try and get a better recollection of my Spinoza and my Deleuze on Spinoza before I answer that. Okay, let's go to Hegel, though. All right? Hegel will basically argue, Hegel's position will be, there is no such thing as a thing in itself. There is no such thing as a noumenal. Right? And what that will mean is that everything gains its place or meaning or its specificity or its definition through its relations to other things. All right? We get back to this. The appearance of something is always relational, right? In the first instance, we could say the red, that thing is red to me, to a subject who apprehends it. It's also red as opposed to being black, as opposed to being blue, as opposed to being white, as opposed to being colorless. And that as opposed to is really crucial in Hegel's thinking. A thing is what it is, not because of what it is in itself, but insofar as it relates, you know, its properties define what it is. But those properties are always relational. Those relations, Hegel will insist, take a certain form, which is a form of negativity and a form of opposition, right? So, you know, the starting point of this is you have to get rid of the idea of a thing in itself. You would literally have to get rid of the idea that this cup somehow would be a cup, even if everything else it was related to, even if the universe itself ceased to exist, that somehow this would still be a cup. Every other part of the universe existed, and it would be the same. It would be a thing in itself, right? Things are what they are, only through their relations to other things. These relations, Hegel will say, are negative. They take the form of a not. They take the form of this cup is this cup because it's not that table, because it's not the room, because it's not something else, because it's not anything else. That's what distinguishes it, its notness, what distinguishes it from all the rest. That's what makes it an individual, right? But the negative has a crucial duality to it. And this is one of the things Hegel will say in the Phenomenology, among other places. In the negative judgment, the copula both separates and connects the thing to its predicate, all right? I'll go back up here. Very briefly, I prefer sitting with the people rather than up here, but the whiteboard's up here. If I say X is not Y, and this is the point, it has to take the form of a negative. I'm saying two things at the same time. I'm saying X is separate from Y, all right? I'm saying they're two separate things. There's a division between them. That's part of what the negativity is. But I'm also saying that Y is part of the identity of X. So they're connected. Because I couldn't define Y. I couldn't define X without Y. So this negative relation has this duality. It separates these two things and it connects them. And this is what Hegel will say, this is what makes it dialectical, is that these two aspects of this relationship are always at play, the separation and the unification. Right? As long as X is not a thing in itself that somehow is prior to its relations to other things. So, I mean, this idea, Hegel, Nietzsche, Deleuze, the idea that the relations are prior to the things related, although there's this whole thing around external relations in Deleuze, but let's keep using the term relation for now. That idea is with all of them, all right? Relations constitute what the thing is, right? Or connections to others and so forth. Hegel will insist that it's negative, all right? And he'll insist that any other kind of understanding of the positivity of these relations only reasserts that these things are somehow things in themselves separate from each other, right? Only the negative will encompass both the separation and connection between them. So when I say that X is not Y, it's also not A, B, C, everything else, all right? I can say what makes this thing an individual is it's not everything else, all right? To be an individual, thing has to be separate from all other things, all right? All other possibilities. That gives it its individuality. That also means, in a paradoxical way, a thing is only what it is because it's related to everything else. And in this sense, Hegel would say we can form a totality, an idea of an absolute, because anything that I would say was somehow outside of this network of relations that X has with everything else would be related to that totality, and therefore would be not that totality, would be related to it and therefore accounted for within it. All right? But it's a world that is a totality of relations, not of things. All right? World is a totality of relations, not things. All right? Now, one way of describing this, which is a useful one, is simply an idea of relations between cities, right? We're in Kharagpur, which is west of Calcutta. If I say, what is Kharagpur? And I say, it's a little town that's west of Calcutta. right? That includes Calcutta within its identity, so to speak, because it helps. You couldn't place it in India without referencing other cities. Right? So those other cities are separate cities, but they're also part of, they're also they're necessarily referred to in order to place it. And it's useful to think of identity in this sense as a thing's place in its relation to other things. If you start thinking about the identity of something in terms of its place, you start to see how this kind of idea of relations can expand itself to include everything, right? You know, get back to this bottle. If I wanted to say what this bottle is in terms of where it is, it's on this table. This table is in this room. This room is in this building. This building is on, you know, is on this campus. This campus is just outside the town. This town is in India. This India is on planet Earth. Earth is in this solar system, right? Right? You could begin to say that to say where it is to say where it is in relation to everything. All right? Sorry? Yeah, the part is within the whole. Yeah. Now, what is this whole? That's the point. Okay? It's a whole of relations. And yeah, let's say it encompasses the universe. Okay? Every piece of matter is related to every other piece of matter, even on opposite ends, so to speak, of the universe. There's still a gravitational attraction, right? So everything is connected to everything else, right? If I were to say there's something that wasn't part of these connections, I would be saying there's something that's not part of the universe. Let's say I was going to say that. Well, everything in the universe is connected, but there's something that is not part of the universe. Well, as soon as I say it's not part of the universe, it's already put in the form of X is not Y. To say it's not part of the universe is to separate it from, but also related to. And so that's the point. It's not negative. It's not related. It's not outside the universe as a thing. And as soon as we say it's outside, well, outside is a negative relationship to an inside. So there's a way in which it's connected, right, and already accounted for. And that's what Hegel's claim is going to be. You can think of a totality, which is a negative totality of relations, in which everything is defined through relations to everything else, and you couldn't posit something outside. You couldn't posit a transcendence. That's the point. So a transcendence in this sense, outside the universe as such. Because to say it's not part of the universe, it already falls under that rule that when you say something is not something else, you're separating and you're connecting. All right? And that's Hegel's kind of trick with this. All right? The individual is individual by not being all other things, but that also means the individual is in a way connected to the universal, and that's part of the, there's going to be this always this unity Hegel will talk about between the individual and the whole, or the individual and the absolute, all right? We get a kind of network of relations that form a totality, where the individual is nothing, but it's, again, as long as the individual is not an individual in itself, as long as you accept that everything, there's nothing kind of left behind, you know, after its relations are removed, because it is nothing but its relations. You get this idea that the individual is nothing but its relations to other things, which means that its relations to other things form a universe. The individual is this universe, right? And you have a totality in that respect. Okay? Hegel referred to this as the identity of identity and difference. Right? The unity of everything, of something with, it, well, it is not. And he will say that it applies not only to, this is where this idea of pushing things up to contradiction comes into play. Pen's over there. X is not only different from Y, A, B, C, D, and everything else, but it's also different from not X. It's contradictory. It's polar opposite. The thing that in Hegel's terms, would be infinitely different and incompatible with X, is still negatively related to it. So this is a unity, Hegel would say, a separation but also a unity of, and this is what makes it the absolute, of even contradictories, right? Of being and non-being, right? That's the way the logic starts. It also starts in the phenomenology as well, right? Being is meant to be the opposite of non-being, or of nothing, right? But that means it's separate from its opposite, but it also is its opposite. And that's going to be Hegel's, the paradox that Hegel points out in the beginning of the logic is being is nothing, and nothing is being. And one way of thinking about it is because being is supposed to be everything, it's supposed to be a totality, it's contentless, right? Because it has nothing that it's separating itself from. So being is nothing, but nothing is being. How do we understand the fact that being is both separate from nothing and it's not separate from nothing? Well, this the logic leads to the next category, leads to becoming, right? So becoming is the unity of this kind of passage back and forth, the way being turns out to be nothing, and it also turns out to be the opposite of nothing, right? And becoming is now going to be, unlike Plato, unlike this idea that there's being on one side, becoming on the other, becoming is just a reflection of being, Hegel would say that becoming is the internal movement of being itself because being relates to nothing as it's contradictory, which nevertheless it has to be connected to, right? So you get that kind of thinking. This is dialectics, right, in Hegel. It's the idea, as I said, the identity of identity and difference. Or identity and contradiction, but let's just say identity of identity and difference. Hegel will refer to this as the concept with a capital C, and as the notion, capital N. He'll refer to it as the absolute, or as, it's absolute knowledge is knowledge of this formulation of things and their connections to one another. All right? We have a notion of the absolute which doesn't depend on a transcendence, and which Hegel will say captures things in their individuality. You might wonder about that because we haven't captured things in their individuality yet. All right, but we're going to have to show how they do. All right. One of Deleuze's critiques is going to be, as much as the dialectic tries to capture things in its individuality, it remains abstract. And what Deleuze will say is what the abstraction, the source of the abstraction, is the understanding of difference as contradiction, as notness, as negation. All right. Yeah?
How similar is this to Sartre's existentialism? Because he talks of nausea, detachment to the world, and then making use of the freedoms that one gets to meet.
Hegel or Sartre is playing around with this whole idea of a dialectic. So yeah, I mean it's now you're asking me to recall Sartre 2 days after I traveled halfway across the world to India. Like the European philosophy that follows it, it's influenced by Hegel, by Kant and Hegel. But, Sartre will, the dialectic of being and nothing is nothingness is, central to Sartre's work. That's another one I'm going to need to think about more. I keep thinking about existentialism as a humanism, which is an article, which is what Sartre also rejects as a poor explanation of existentialism.
And he talks about not X than X.
Yeah.
Complete detachment as to what piece of furniture is, or maybe.
Yeah.
What does it mean to me right now in this world?
Right, yeah. I mean, okay. I mean, in part, this. You mean in terms of the idea of freedom from the given? Kind of thing. Yeah, I mean, I suppose.
It's just a piece of example, but then anything else.
Yeah. I don't know. The answer, I think, is going to come from going on with this, and probably it'll become clearer.
I just wanted to put it.
Yeah. I don't know yet. It's a short answer. We'll keep it in mind. We'll discuss it as we continue on, okay? All right. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah. This is, as I said, what Hegel will call absolute knowledge, or he will at least say it's an indication of what absolute knowledge is. It represents the, it reveals the nature of absolute knowledge, he'll say, in the phenomenology in the introduction. We haven't really gotten to absolute knowledge yet, but I'll explain that in a minute. On a political level, I should just say, this is going to be reflected in Hegel's idea of what the state is, right? The state is going to be, the state at the end of history is going to be the embodiment of this idea of identity and difference, right? Where people are individuals and recognize each other as individuals, but in such a way that they also form part of a single community, right? So that's how the absolute is brought to earth, in a way, is in the community, right? That's in fact what absolute knowing is. Sorry? Elaborate on that. We will elaborate on that later on when we discuss the philosophy of the state, but Hegel's idea of a state, of the ethical state, is a state in which people can realize both their separation as individuals who are free from each other and autonomous, but also recognize each other and see a commonality in a community, right? Does that make sense? And there's a set of rights and institutions and moral principles and ethical institutions that help realize that experience. And it's going to be the experience of being part of a group but also being an individual, right? So there's a liberal idea of like Western liberal political thought which always puts the state on one side and the individual on the other and says the state is, the bigger the state is, the less freedom the individual has. And that opposition is one of the things that Hegel will say a certain kind of state can overcome. So the state isn't your opponent, so to speak, but it's the vehicle of the realization of your freedom, and so is everyone else. So the idea that there are others in the community whom are different from you is also, they both are and are not, right? And like it's through their difference that they're also recognized as also being human, right? We'll see some of that when we get into the master-slave dialectic, which I hope we will get into today. How much time do we have? We have about an hour? Is that right? Sorry? I'll just keep going. All right. I think we have an hour and 10 minutes left in this first day. Okay. Shall we go on?
Yeah.
All right. We're up to Hegel now. All right. So one of Hegel's goals, one of the things he says, for example, in the philosophy of right, is that the real is rational and the rational is real. All right. What he means is by this, the rational is the notion and reality is reality. All right. And to say that they're both the same is going to really be that the world as it is, as it becomes as well, conforms to this formulation, all right? And that's going to be crucial because demonstrating that the real is rational and the rational is real, or that the identity of identity and difference really exists as a principle of reality, as a way of comprehending and grasping reality, if the real wasn't rational, the rational could still exist but only as a formalism, all right? So where we are at, by the way, this identity of identity and difference is a formalism. It's just something that you could work out through a consideration of the fact that things are connected to everything else. So all we've done so far is say everything is what it is because it's defined against everything else. This definition against both separates it from and connects it to everything else. The conclusion is everything is connected to everything else. And your answer would be like, so what? If I told you that, this is the answer to everything. Everything is connected to everything else, you'd be like, yeah, so what? Because it's just a formality, all right, is a kind of obvious point. It's just a formal point, and it doesn't tell you what anything is yet. So Hegel's goal is going to be to show that that formulation doesn't just stand there as an abstract formulation of the fact that everything is connected to everything else, that there's a way in which it literally concretizes itself so that it becomes an account of a concrete kind of absolute knowledge, all right, where we really do explain, you know, what things are and why things are what they are, at a level of certainty, right? ultimately what this formulation is supposed to explain through its own internal mechanisms is, you could say, the meaning and place of nature, history, God, and man. All right? We'll understand what is natural, what is spiritual, how humans are both part of nature and humans are separate from nature. We'll understand the relation between the human and the divine. We'll understand how the divine is actually not transcendent from the world, but is actually realized in the world. We'll understand how that's connected to history. History will have a meaning and a sense, all right? And the identity of identity and difference will explain this. And once we've done that, we've sort of accounted for everything. You know, we've accounted for God, the world, and man, and nature, all right? There's nothing really left to explain. But we have to explain it in a way that removes the abstractions, all right? And one of the things that, I don't know if we'll get into this week, but I'll try and run through it briefly at some point. Hegel will refer to this as absolute knowledge, knowledge, you could say, of the meaning and place of nature, history, and God and man. It doesn't mean that everything is known in a certain scientific way. For example, one of the things that Hegel will say is, nature remains unknowable. It can be described by science, but it can never be grasped in its spirituality, because nature is not spirit, right? And what he'll say about human beings and science is that science can describe the natural world, it can't know the natural world, it can't have an absolute knowledge in that sense, but absolute knowledge will be knowledge of why nature remains something that could only be described and not known. And one of the things Hegel will say in response on the other side of that is, what is knowable is something very human. It's our connections to one another with a certain kind of clarity and a certain kind of certainty that we don't have in our relations to the natural world, because we only describe it. Our relations to each other in a certain kind of society is we grasp both our differences from one another and our common humanity, our common spirit. Right? And that's actually where absolute knowledge is going to lie. So that thing about the political community, absolute knowledge is realized in that community, as opposed to being realized in, say, the scientific study, which, you know, gives you knowledge of all the fundamental forces of the universe. Hegel would say, even if you did find all the fundamental forces in the universe and you understood how they related, you'd still be describing something rather than knowing it. All right. Well, we'll have to see how this goal gets itself worked out. One way of thinking about this is if it's not worked out, the identity of identity and difference, this idea everything is connected, everything else, it's at best a model for thinking about the way real things work and are connected, but it's not more than that, and Hegel wants it to be more than that, all right? So that's what he's going to try and proceed to do, at least in the phenomenology. This is the text we're going to focus on, rather than, say, the logic, and rather than, say, the encyclopedia writings. I'll focus on the phenomenology because it's a nice, well, it fits well actually also with what Deleuze is doing. Okay? Two ways in which Hegel is going to try and do this, or two terms, are going to be dialectics and phenomenology, right? To get at this idea of absolute knowledge as something concrete. So what is dialectics? Dialectics is what we've already been through. It's this idea of negativity as constitutive. It's the idea that things are what they are because of their negative relations to what they are not. One of the ways Hegel explains this is as a process where something goes from being what it is in itself to being what it is for others through its connections to others. It's a movement from being in itself to being for others to being for itself through others. All right? Being in itself, he says, is an abstraction. The thing in itself is an abstraction. When thought of in isolation, it's just cut off from everything else, right? That exists, Hegel says, only as a moment of the way in which things appear. In truth, things are defined through their relations to others. That's being for another. Being for self is how it's established concretely through its connections to others. It really is what it is, not through its separation, but through its connection and its return. And dialectics is going to be that. That's why dialectics is, you know, another formulation of it is it involves a negation and a negation of that negation. Right? The first negation is things are separate from each other. The second is things are what they are through their connection. and that they're individual only by being connected to everything else. That's the negation of the negation, also known as a synthesis or as a sublation. All right. So dialectics is about that. And the claim Hegel makes is that it helps you move from the abstract to the concrete. Now, I've actually mentioned this a couple of times, but we haven't really talked about what abstraction is and what the concrete is. If you take a non-philosophy course in empirical political science or something else like that, and they decide to make a little snide comment about those philosophy or those theory classes, what they always like to say about them is they're abstract. All right? And it's a complete misuse of the word abstraction. What they mean when they say something is abstract is they think it means out of this world. All right? It's in the heavens. It's like in this disconnected from reality. All right? And what it really means, what they're really trying to say is it's complex, and it's too complex for them. All right? That's secretly what they're saying. They're not letting on. They're pretending that it's abstract. But that's not even what abstraction means. Okay. What is abstraction as a technical term? Well, let's get back to this. This is a white piece of paper. This is a white pad. That's a white board. The sort of off-white skin or something. All right? These things are separate entities, separate things that have qualities, many qualities, right? This is rectangular. This is, you know, flexible. It bends. All right? And it's white. Whiteness is just one quality that this multiform thing has. Now, we all have brains that have a power of taking the white from here and the white from there and the white from the board and kind of holding it on our heads as whiteness, as a separate thing. And there's no such, I mean, I mentioned this before, there's no such thing as whiteness. There are only white things. It's a quality that is always accompanied with other qualities, right? But by power of abstraction, I hold it up as a separate thing. In part, I turn from being a quality amongst, you know, the many qualities that things have into a substantive, whiteness, right? To have an abstract view of the world is precisely to do that. It's taking a multi-sided reality and holding one side of it up as reality, as a reality, right? That's what I'm basically doing when I abstract. When I come up with the idea, the concept of whiteness, by abstracting from different white things, this you know, thing that I hold as an entity, as a singular concept. Because in truth, that whiteness is always embedded in relations and in things that have many qualities, many different relations. All right? So, and that's going to be, you know, basically what abstraction is. That's the way Hegel treats abstraction. And abstraction is always a one-sided view of reality. All right? So, if I say, this thing is a separate, independent thing in itself, this chair, that's an abstraction. Because in truth, this chair is this chair because of its relations to other things. So, when I start to see how this chair because of its relations to other things, I'm getting a more concrete, literally, understanding of reality. A different way of thinking about it is it's a one-sided view of reality. It's a one-dimensional view of reality, or maybe a two-dimensional view of reality. And to move from the abstract to the concrete is to move to a more multi-dimensional reality. All right? And that's also where dialectics as well as phenomenology come in. Yeah, here's an example. All right. If I showed you, if you were all standing right in front and you could only see the front face of this watch, all right, you just see flat the front face of the watch, and you thought that that was the whole reality of the watch, because that's the only thing that appears to you, all right? That's an abstraction, because this watch has many sides to it. It has depth, all right? But you see one face of it. It's like seeing an abstraction, like seeing one side of reality, all right? Now, imagine I can show you, and I never remember how to do this by virtue of whenever I give the example, but I imagine if I could show you that in seeing this one side, even though you didn't see the back side of it, you would have to know there was a way of deriving the fact that there was a second side of it that you couldn't see without, you know, you didn't walk around, but you knew that there was a back side to it, all right? And then I showed you that that backside was connected to the front side. It came out of, it was kind of derived from the necessities of the one side that you saw. Then I have two sides of reality, right? And that's basically what the dialectic does. It basically takes one side of reality and shows that one side has to have an opposing side, and then there are two sides to reality, and we do the thing again. We can derive other sides of reality. So we can start with the abstract. This is Hegel's promise, Hegel's claim. The dialectic can start with the abstract, and it can concretize itself by showing internal transitions that you go from one side of reality to show that an opposite side of reality has to exist, to show that those two sides are connected, they form a reality together, so you now have a two-sided reality, and proceed, because even that two-sided reality remains abstract. All right? And the dialectic is meant to proceed in this way. It's not meant to just show how things are connected to each other, but in showing it, it gives you a more multi-dimensional picture of reality. Now, by the way, that makes a more complex reality, which confuses certain people because it's too complex for them, and they respond by talking about how this is such an abstraction of reality because it's disconnected from the world. That's the crazy thing that tends to happen. It's irritating.
Let's have coffee.
Oh, should we take another break?
Yeah.